about the topic of Islam and Christianity. And we've come to our second topic. We have four wonderful guests with us tonight, representing both sides. And the topic tonight, is Muhammad a true prophet of God? And during this series of programs, we open up each half hour with a five-minute presentation by one of the representatives from each side. And to begin this half hour, we're going to have Dr. Jamel Badawi talk about the evidence concerning, is Muhammad a true prophet of God? You may begin.
First of all, five basic points about prophethood, because it's related. One, God is one, he cares for humanity and wishes good for them. Two, humanity is one, it needs guidance and searches for meaning and direction in life. Three, it follows that the essential divine guidance is one, in essence, to attain peace through submission to, obedience to, and love to God, which is the literal meaning of the term Islam, which we believe has been the faith and message of all of the prophets of God throughout history, the greatest of whom are Noah, Abraham, Moses, Jesus, and Muhammad, may peace and blessing be upon them all. Four, those messengers were the best role models for mankind in faith, moral conduct, and leadership. It is an article of faith in Islam to believe in all of them, to love them, and to respect them. Five, all prophets were sent to their people, except for Prophet Muhammad, who is believed by Muslims to be chosen by God to be sent to the entire mankind with the universal message. His message is the culmination of the essence of all of the previous revelations. Now, why do Muslims accept Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, as the messenger of God? Eight reasons. One, he did claim this, and there is absolutely no reason to belie his claim, since he was acknowledged even by his enemies as a model of integrity and truthfulness. His nickname was Al-Amin, the trustworthy. Two, there is no ground to dismiss his claim as religious visions or hallucination unless we dismiss all other revelations and prophets. Three, there is a clear absence of any ulterior motive on his part, not like today's prophets. He lived in a greater poverty and suffering as a result of fulfilling his prophetic mission. The simplicity and austerity of his life continued even after his victory over the pagan who sought to destroy him and to destroy Islam. And until his death, he lived in that simple life. Four, what he taught was consistent, we insist, with the core of the message of all prophets before him, to worship the one and only God of all and follow his guidance in our lives. It is inconceivable to say that all Jewish rabbis and prophets, one after the other, did not understand the language and did not pick the idea of triune godhood. Five, his life was the embodiment of his teaching and a comprehensive model for mankind under all circumstances, peace and war, all circumstances, and in all roles needed for realistic human life on earth. Six, his advent was accompanied by numerous extraordinary signs, one of which is the 100% accuracy of all prophecies that he made, and the Quran, which we'll discuss in a different topic later on. Seven, the fruits of following him sincerely, not paying lip service like most Muslims do today, includes the total positive transformation of the lives of individuals and nations. In fact, there is a sheet out there that gives witnesses of many non-Muslim writers. It's available outside. I have a few also with me. People who are not Muslims who make very glaring remark about the character and impact. One Jewish writer by the name of Hart, he said, among the 100 most influential personalities in human history, including prophets, number one was Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Finally, according to the Quran, the advent of his coming was prophesied in many scriptures, including the Bible. There is a brochure outside. I have more of that. The Bible speaks quite clearly about a prophet, a great one, to come from the descent of Ishmael. The promise of blessing is not only limited to Isaac, it's also the descendants of Ishmael. The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 18, speaks about a prophet like unto Moses, not a son of God like unto Moses. Deuteronomy 33 speaks about Moses, Jesus, and Muhammad because it speaks about Sinai, Seir, which is in Palestine, and Paran, which is, according to the Bible, in chapter 21 of Genesis, is Mecca. Even the name Mecca or Becca, which is an alternative name, appear in the 84th Psalm of David. In the book of Isaiah, chapter 21, verses 13 through 17, there is an amazing description of the migration of Prophet Muhammad from Mecca to Medina, and it connected with the tribe of Kedar, which is, according to the Bible, the descendants of Ishmael. John the Baptist, when he came, was interviewed by the Jews, as reported in the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verses 19 through 27. And it was quite clear that the Jews expected three personalities. Asked him, are you the Christ? He said, no. Are you Elijah? He said, no. And then they asked a third person. They expected, are you that prophet? And again, he said, no. That prophet is none but the prophet like unto Moses with a complete code of law. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank
you. I'll take a check for the remaining seconds.
Okay, 2 seconds, all right. Responding from the Christian side will be Dr. Anis Shirosh. And let me just say as we begin this portion that for both of our teams on the platform, that in Islam, as a Muslim, you are to be very honorable when you talk about Jesus. So to even disagree with a Christian, you have to be very careful. And I've told these men that they can have freedom and that we recognize when you question some of our beliefs, that is not going to be taken by us to be a disrespect on your part. But I hope that it'll go the other way as well, that when we talk about our views concerning Muhammad and the Quran and Allah and so on, that the questions that we would have, they are questions and they are to hold no disrespect. But we do want to get to the truth question. So hopefully that will put a little oil on the water here as we start out. And Anis, you may begin.
إنني أحييكم جميعا باسم يسوع ابن بلدي ربي ومخلصي. I greet you in the name of Jesus, the man from my hometown, my Lord and Savior. From Deuteronomy 18, I read from verse 21 and 22. And if you say in your heart, how shall we know the word which the Lord has not spoken? When a prophet speaks in the name of the Lord, if the thing does not happen or come to pass, that is the thing which the Lord has not spoken. The prophet has spoken it presumptuously. You shall not be afraid of him. Muhammad never gave a prophecy in terms of matching the prophets of the Old Testament or even the apostles or Jesus our Lord. The most damaging thing about this whole matter is every Muslim every day and any time he testifies the kalima which states أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله, meaning I testify there is no God but Allah and Muhammad is his what? Apostle, not prophet. In fact, we read in Surah 3, 144 that Muhammad is but a messenger. Never is he a prophet. And a messenger, like the apostles, were sent with a message, but not a prophet, who talked to God and God talked to him. He never states that. It was always the angel Gabriel. Something else of interest, and that is, what did he do for 15 years before he began to claim he saw these visions? And what new revelation did he give us that we do not have before already seen and depicted elsewhere? As for Moses, let me share with you what Peter declared on the day when he was preaching in the city of Jerusalem in chapter 4 of Acts, verse 22. For Moses truly said to the fathers, the Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brethren. Him you shall hear in all things whatsoever he says to you. And it shall come to pass that every soul who will not hear the prophet shall be utterly destroyed from among the people. Yes, and all the prophets from Samuel and those who follow, as many as have spoken, have also foretold these days. You are the sons of the prophet and of the covenant which God made with our father, saying to Abraham, and in your seed all the families of the earth shall be blessed. And this terminology following these statements indicates that the prophet is indeed Jesus Christ and not Muhammad. Now we come to a very significant matter that's always brought up, and that is, if one is familiar with the term gospel according to the Quran, he may wonder why in the world the word is never plural. Every knowledgeable individual knows that by the time Muhammad came, the canon of the Bible was established and the 66 books comprising it were a fact of life. Therefore, we ask, why didn't Muhammad speak of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John? Here is the astonishing discovery. Ladies and gentlemen, we discover that from historical documents that attest to the fact that Waraqah bin Nawfal, the uncle of Muhammad's first wife, Khadijah,
had indeed translated a so-called Gospel of Matthew from Hebrew into Arabic. We know that this particular gospel did not include the divinity of Jesus, neither the Trinity of God, because it was written by unbelieving Jews. We have pieces and particles copied in the Quran and other contemporary books which explain to you why Muhammad spoke only of the gospel of Jesus rather than the gospel of Jesus, reflecting the same idea, because written by unbelieving Jews, that Jesus was not Son of God, there was no Trinity, and so forth. Unfortunately, this gospel is extinct, but much like the Iliad or other documents, we have sufficient verses here and there to know such a book was in existence and came to Muhammad's attention while preparing the Quran over a period of 23 years and 15 years before that in preparation before the writing came. Sahih Bukhara, volume 1, page 298, and Sahih Muslim, volume 1, page 7879, testify to this gospel's existence. Waraka bin Nawfal was the first and only man of wisdom. Khadija sought for counsel when Muhammad began to relate to her his suicide the tendencies and visions of Gabriel. According to As-Sira Al-Halabiyya, volume 1, page 155 and 363, and As-Sira Al-Makkiyya, volume 1, page 123, Waraka, get ready for a surprise, was actually a Christian pastor. Who was it that encouraged Muhammad to marry Khadija and perform the wedding ceremony? You know by now, it was none other than Waraka. The fact that the marriage was monogamous until Khadija's death identified as a Christian marriage. He never married anybody else till later when she died. Muhammad made regular visit with Waraka. Additionally, the old preacher, according to Ibn Hashim, volume 1, page 174, spent an entire month with Muhammad annually in the Hira caves until Waraka died, where he later claimed he saw the vision of Gabriel. Chronologically, the dry spell of revelation corresponds precisely with Waraka's death, until Muhammad was comforted and encouraged by his wife to continue the revelations.
Thank you very much. All right, we're going to take a break and we'll come back and have our discussion with these men. Please stick with us. All right, we're back. And my first question is going to be to Dr. Hussein Morrissey. And what you said was that Muhammad was a prophet of God because he claimed to be. Do we have anything besides Muhammad's own word that he was a prophet? What proof for a person that might be a skeptic?
Prophecies, hundreds of prophecies in the Quran, open prophecies that could have went wrong, multiple prophecies that we can go through.
Give us one.
Just one. The victory of the Romans over the Persians in few years, at the time when the Roman Empire had been sacked more than 100 years ago, and every indication was that it had been already destroyed, flat out in the Quran, that the Persians won over the Romans, and in few years, the Romans will win against the Persians. And it happened exactly 6 years later.
What surah, what surah is that?
30.
30, number 30.
Read it for us.
Well, I do not...
The Romans have been defeated in the lower part of the land, and after they defeat, they will win again in a few years. In the Arabic language, few years means something between 3 to 9. And the reason for not specifying the exact date is that the military battles, as you know, can sometimes begin with one particular move or at the final end. But it did happen actually within that term, and there's another prophecy in the same surah also.
Well, another thing that Brother Anis chose to ignore, multiple physical miracles that are attributed to Prophet Muhammad. However, the Muslims never make any big deal about it. They do not go around and saying Prophet Muhammad did such and such physical miracle, because physical miracles become to be part of history, and some people believe it, some other people do not believe it. But the biggest miracle that Prophet Muhammad did bring to mankind, and it contains a challenge to mankind to examine it, 1400 years, the Quran, it says, if you are capable, or if any human person is capable of coming up with something of similar material, they will never be able to. Millions have tried, none succeeded. And it is a miracle, a living miracle, that a Christian can examine, and I invite all of you, and the audience, and the viewers, to examine it for yourself and judge for yourself. You will find it the biggest miracle that ever came to mankind.
Let me ask you this. Does not the Quran say about Muhammad that he did no miracles 7 different times?
Yes, there were references in the Quran to miracles. For example, in Surah number 9, about the battle of Badr and the divine intervention in that battle, There are several mentioned and testified to in the Quran itself, yet some people misunderstood some statements in the Quran.
What do you do about the statements where it actually says that he did no miracles?
No, I didn't say that. I didn't say he did not do miracles.
No, I'm saying the Quran says that, so I'm saying if you say have the Quran saying that he did no miracles, don't you have a contradiction when the Quran...
The Quran never said that.
The Quran never said that Prophet Muhammad didn't do miracles. What the Quran said is that they say some of the unbelievers came to him, just like they came, the Jews came to challenge Jesus, peace be upon him. They said, we will not believe in you until you make the earth bring springs, until the mountains are moved. And then it says, tell them, glory be to Allah, I am only a human messenger. And there have been instances when Jesus did not respond to any demand for miracle like push button, but it did not negate that he had miracles. It simply said that those people, even if you give miracles, they will not listen.
Does the Quran, yes or no, say that Muhammad did no miracles?
Nowhere
does it say he performed any miracle. In fact, he told them that he was sent as a warner, as an apostle, as a messenger,
as a preacher,
but he never says that he was able to perform any miracle. That's why the Jews rejected him. When in the beginning they welcomed him into Medina, which was controlled by the Jews, and where he was a good friend with them, and later turned against them because they wouldn't accept him as
again,
a
that is the
this
research.
Does not negate.
That is a private research.
In your talk, you mentioned the fact that Muhammad was predicted in the Bible to come.
Yes.
And in your writings, you've talked about the fact that he is the one that Jesus talked about when he said he would send the Paraclete, the Comforter.
Yes.
Now, you quote John 14, so that must be one of those that's an accurate verse that has come down to us. Is that correct?
Yeah.
All right, now let's read the verse then. Jesus says, but the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things. Now, you're saying that's Muhammad.
Yes.
But Jesus goes on and says, and he will remind you, that's the apostles, of everything I have said to you. So the question is, how could, if that's Muhammad, did Muhammad tell the disciples 600 years before that time?
Yes.
I think you have to go back a little bit, John, to chapter 16 also, in which he said, how be it when he, the Spirit of truth, is to come, he will lead you to all truth, for he shall not speak of himself, but whatever God will teach him, he will teach you.
Yeah, Hussein,
how can God teach the Holy Spirit if the Holy Spirit is God?
What I'm asking you, Hussein, is the fact is Jesus said that the Holy Spirit would come and remind the apostles. Are you saying that Muhammad was present?
Yes. The address that is given to the Prophet is meant to address all others. Just like Jesus was addressing his contemporaries and he says, you will see the Son of Man coming in the cloud. It does not necessarily mean those people in front of him. It could mean also generations. And Prophet Muhammad indeed reminded the followers of Jesus who were living in his time that this was the true teaching of Jesus, and the Quran document the fact that many of them had tears flowing from their eyes when the Prophet recited the truth about Jesus to them.
All right, now, let me get the linguist on the board here. Does paraclete mean all of those things in the Gospels?
Parakletos means one who is called alongside to help.
Right.
All right. He was a helper.
And he was a helper. Comforter.
Yet the point is very clear in verse 26, that whoever it is going to help the then living apostles who are sitting before Jesus and who are going to have the responsibility of recording the New Testament, that he will bring to their recollection what Jesus has said. Now, that could not refer to something that happened in the 7th century AD.
Let me remind you one thing, Dr. Arsha. Jesus said, I must go in order for the Comforter to come.
Right.
All of us know that the Holy Spirit was present before Jesus, during the time of Jesus, and after Jesus.
True.
So Jesus made it conditional that I must go in order for the Comforter to come.
And he spoke about on the prophet, 50th day.
Another Comforter, just like himself, another prophet to come.
But
he spoke about the revelation
not
to come.
Prophet.
After Jesus, peace be upon him, not one single prophet that came with a revelation other than Muhammad.
Right.
Revelation that came but the Quran.
Hussein, we got a minute left. Shrosh, you've got just one minute. That's
okay,
it.
Here it is. The Paracletan's work was not to gather armies and gain victories with earthly weapons, but to convict men of sin, of righteousness, and judgment. And that's what happened on the day of Pentecost. That's why 3,000 were saved instead of people being killed. His teaching was to glorify not himself, but Christ, and do the work of Christ sent him to do. according to
John 16:14. If it were true that the Holy Spirit resolved all problems and gave all information in the day of the Pentecost, why is it that the disciples were still differing about who Jesus is, and until now you have thousands of denominations?
Exactly.
Do we have thousands of denominations differing about
we
Jesus?
We have also 150 denominations among the Muslims. This is not a point of interest.
That's your private, that's your private research.
All right, let's research. Let's look again. We're going to pick it up.